Over the course of my channel, I've made a video or two, or 10, about how different places got their names. What I did not mention in any of these videos, however, is that most of these are what's called an exonym, meaning outside name, or names that originated outside of the place that they describe. And in recent years, there's been a trend of changing names from the common exonym back to an older endonym, an inside name, or a name that actually comes from within the country that it describes. So what I wanted to do was to try to figure out what some of the endonyms would be for the places that I've already covered, and see if they'd make a good replacement for the exonym we know them by. I guess it doesn't matter where I start, so let's start with America. Like I said, America is, in all likelihood, an exonym, being named after the Italian explorer Amerigo Vespucci. But in my opinion, this land is too big and diverse for any single name to encompass it, so let's start with just South America. Easily the largest and most influential civilization to inhabit this continent were the Inca, so I think it's appropriate to rename South America with them in mind. In their native language, they called the world that they inhabited Tahuantinsuyu, which, well, it's not catchy, but it does make a pretty good description of the continent. Tahuantinsuyu translates into Land of the Four Quarters, referring to the four different regions or quarters which fell under the Inca Empire. Chinchaysuyu, the northernmost quarter, reached all the way into Colombia and consists of mostly forested foothills and some mountains. Cuntasuyu fell mostly within the Atacama Desert and surrounding arid regions. Antasuyu was a very thin strip of land bordering on the Amazon rainforest and got its name from the Anti people who inhabited the region. It's from these Anti people that the Andes Mountains got their name. Lastly, to the south was Colasuyu, reaching down into Chile and even Argentina, and contained the continent's tallest mountain at its southern reaches. Together, these four quarters cover essentially every distinct climate zone found in the continent, and uniting them under one name makes for a pretty inclusive title. So Tahuantinsuyu it is. Next, we're moving into North America, and I actually want to break up this into two smaller lands, Central America, going as far up as the US-Mexico border, and, well, the rest of North America, the United States and Canada. Central America was home to two other very recognizable civilizations, the Aztec and the Maya. But the Maya weren't really a unified civilization, and rather a collection of city-states similar to the Greeks, so they didn't have any one name for themselves, instead going by whatever town or city they lived in. And the Aztecs actually originated as a people group outside of this region, somewhere above the Gulf of California. And because we're trying to make endonyms, they are disqualified. But when the Aztecs migrated south into central Mexico, they found the ruins of a once great civilization and claimed that they had descended from it. It was this far more ancient civilization that built some of the most impressive pre-Columbian structures in America, including many pyramids and cities. These people were the Teotihuacanos, and their territory was centered around the city of Teotihuacan, the ruins of which can be found 40 miles north of Mexico City today. This was the largest city the Americas had seen before the arrival of Columbus, and influence from this civilization had spread to all other civilizations in the area. Because the influence that these people and this city had was so important to the region, I think the name Teotihuacan serves as a good name for Central America as a whole, and so that's what I'm going with. Finally, moving to the rest of North America, I'm going to choose the Powhatan people to decide a name. I'm choosing them because they belong to the Greater Algonquin language group, which spread across a large portion of the continent and was the biggest group to be found here. I'm specifically choosing the Powhatan, however, because they were the first people that the English settlers to North America came across when they founded the city of Jamestown. And if it hadn't already been given a European name, the settlers likely would have asked the Powhatan what they called the land and used some form of that name. If they had done this, they most likely would have gotten the answer Sinacomaca, which translates into densely inhabited land, as it was home to over 30 unified tribes under the Powhatan Confederacy. And this description holds true to this day, as Virginia is part of the Eastern Seaboard, the largest population center on the continent, containing over 115 million people, although very few of those can actually trace their heritage back to the original Powhatan, or even Algonquin people. Okay, so far we have three endonyms to replace one exonym, and now it's time to get out of the Americas. I might as well say it now, I think I'm going to keep Antarctica, because, well, there aren't really any endonyms for it, because no one's from Antarctica. Well, maybe then we should let Emilio Marcos Palma name it, considering he was the first recorded person to ever be born on the continent in 1978, so I guess he could be considered the oldest native to the land. But yeah, other than that, Antarctica remains Antarctica. So next, let's look at Africa. Now, if you watched my video on how Africa got its name, you'd know the origin of the name Africa is still a bit of a mystery, and may either be Phoenician, or Berber, or Greek, or Latin. And considering the Berbers were native to the continent, there's a 25% chance Africa could actually be an endonym. But for our purposes, let's just try and find another one. So the agreed upon oldest civilization in Africa were the Egyptians around the Nile River. It was here that the first African written language, and only the second written language in the world, was developed. So I believe it's here that we'll find the oldest endonym for Africa. The Egyptians had two names for the world they knew of. Kemet was used to describe where they lived along the banks of the Nile, and then Deshret was meant to describe the desert beyond the river, which, if you ask me, is suspiciously close to the word desert. But basically, Kemet was used to describe Egypt, while Deshret was for the rest of the known world, and what would have been the rest of Africa. Because of this, I'm tempted to say Deshret is a better name for the land as a whole, but looking at the translations, well, let's just say I started to question this. Deshret translates into red land, meant to describe the color of the desert sands beyond the Nile, while Kemet translates into black land, originally meant to describe the fertile black soil deposited on the riverbanks of the Nile during the floods each year. And when considering a name that can encompass the scope of the African continent, I think Kemet is a much better fit, and the same way it originally described the dark soils which allowed the Egyptian civilization to prosper, it could come to mean the people of Africa who allow the current troubled continent as a whole to prosper in the future. If you don't like that though, the South African Zulu word for earth, or just land in general, is Mbaba, and the Swahili word is Dunya. So maybe we could break Africa into three just like we did the Americas. Okay, on to Europe. Now, the most popular theory is that Europe comes from the Greek Euris and Ops, meaning wide face, to describe the scope of the land here. And since Greece, well, at least most of Greece anyway, is on mainland Europe, this is already an endonym. However, there are some theories that the name had an Akkadian or Phoenician origin, and if true, would mean that the name came from the modern-day Middle East, and would qualify it as an exonym. So, for fun, and so that Europe doesn't feel left out, let's just assume one of those theories is true, and Europe is in fact an exonym. To find a definite endonym then, we need to ignore the Romans and the Greeks, as they both used some form of Europe, and instead we're going to need to look elsewhere with different people groups. An often forgotten people group that had a huge impact on the continent were the Celts, who got their start as a distinct people group in this general area, from eastern France through southern Germany and Switzerland and into Austria, all the way to Hungary. From this original Celtic homeland, they expanded throughout Europe until they inhabited nearly all of Western Europe. Because of their huge area of influence, many names throughout the continent are actually already Celtic in origin, so I think they're a good choice to focus in on. But since the Celts were more of a collection of people with a similar language rather than a unified civilization, much like the Mayans, there wasn't a single name they had for themselves or their land. But the Celts definitely did have patterns in what they liked to name things after, and collecting some of the most common words or sound given to places, we have a list of words to choose from and build our own name with. The stars next to each word means that they've been reconstructed using similar modern words in languages like Welsh or Irish that are still living languages to figure out what the root Celtic word must have been. Looking at these and thinking about what best fits, two stand out to me. The first one is Magos, which became Mace in Welsh to mean field and Mach in Irish to mean plain, both of which describe a lot of Europe pretty well, which mostly consists of large open green fields. The second root word that sticks out to me is Windul, which in those same languages became Wen or Gwyn to mean white or blessed in Welsh, and Fionn in Irish to mean fair. Putting these two roots together, we can reconstruct a name like Windmagos or Windmagol. I'll be honest, I'm not really an expert at language reconstruction, so if there's a better way to put these two together, let me know in the comments. Essentially, however, this name means a fair, blessed, or yeah, white, field or plain. And I mean, these are all accurate, and if we're calling Africa black land, we might as well call Europe white field. No one's gonna get offended by either of these, right? But if we want, we can change this from the old reconstructed Celtic language into one that's still around today. Translating this into Welsh, we get something like Windmace or possibly Gwynmace, which I don't know, looks pretty cool to me, or we could switch it into Irish as Fionnmach, which I don't know, might sound cool to someone watching. I'll let you decide on that one. Next up is Arabia, which actually is also already an endonym coming from the ancient Semitic languages which originated here, meaning the name Arabia traces back to Arabia, which means we can skip it. Just kidding. While Arabia might be an endonym, the Arabian Peninsula belongs to the larger place which, maybe one day I'll make a video about this, I think should be considered its own continent, and that is the Middle East. Whether or not you agree with me on that though, we can both agree that the term Middle East definitely originated outside of this place and could use its own endonym. For this, I'm going back to the Semitic language group which originated in this region for an endonym. Luckily, unlike the Celts, the people here decided to give their land a name. Actually, two names. In Arabic, the term Maghreb refers to the western portion of the Arab world, literally translating into the west, where the sun sets. Then, for the eastern side of the Arab world, the name Mashreq is given, which can be used to describe roughly this area. Now, this doesn't perfectly align with what we're going for, spilling over a bit into Africa through Egypt and Sudan, but it does include a big portion of the Middle East as well, and sometimes things can't always be perfect, so Mashreq it is. India, however, is another story. Now, technically, the name India does come from the Sanskrit word Sindhu, which did originate here, but the Vedas used the word Sindhu to describe the Indus River and not the land here, and it was foreigners who confused the name of the river for that of the land. Instead, the Vedas actually gave a different name to describe the Indian subcontinent, Bharatakhanda, and the people of India still call their country Bharat. The name Bharatakhanda, however, no surprise, comes in two parts. Khanda can sometimes be replaced with Kshetra, which can either mean a temple or a residence, usually a divine one. Bharata then refers to the legendary emperor of India, also named Bharata, who is important but I don't have time to explain why, but Bharata can further be translated into cherished. So then Bharatakhanda becomes the cherished residence, which I think is another good way to refer to the land that you live in, so that's what we're going with. And then this could also be expanded to the Indian Ocean so that it becomes the Bharata Ocean, or the cherished ocean. Okay, so now we can move onto the continent of Asia as a whole, which, while first used by the Greeks, is thought to have come from either the Hittites or the Akkadians, and therefore could also qualify as an endonym. But I'll be honest, Asia is ginormous, and since we typically only associate China and the rest of what is East Asia with the term, instead of the Middle East where this name comes from, it still feels like an exonym. Being such a big place with so many people, I think East Asia deserves a term of its own. To find this, we'll need to go back to the oldest civilization in the region, ancient China, which was the seed culture for the rest of the countries here, just like what the Teotihuacans were for the Aztecs and Maya. Here, the people had the idea of a place called Xianxia, which was meant to describe the entire world, everything that was known to them, or even everything that existed. Literally, Xianxia translates into under heaven, very similar to the phrase everything under the sun in English. And considering the only areas the ancient Chinese really knew about at the time was Greater East Asia, I think it fits. Okay, so that leaves us with Australia, or what people have started to refer to as Oceania, which includes all of the far-off Pacific Islands as well. Either way, though, Australia and Oceania both have European origins, so neither can be considered an endonym. Now, before Europeans came to this region, it was inhabited largely by Polynesians, Micronesians, and Melanesians, all of which, similar to the Celtics and the Mayans, never really unified into a single nation. This again makes it hard to come up with just one name when there's so many different people groups to choose from. And this time, I'm going to go with the most populous group still around today, who are the Maori people, Polynesian descendants who lived on the North Island of New Zealand. In native Maori, the term Wanua translated into land, ground, territory, or even country, so it's fitting to call the continent here, whether it be Australia or Oceania, Wanua. But I'm not done yet. The people who lived here were extremely talented seafarers and navigators capable of sailing for thousands of miles in some of the coolest canoes you'll ever see. And so one could argue that they lived in the water just as much as they did on land, so I'm going to make this a double name maker. Since the Pacific Ocean is also an exonym, as Pacific comes from Latin, I think it's more appropriate to use another Maori word. This time Tawharawa, which means ocean. Then you can call all of this just Tawharawa, or you could say it's the Tawharawa Ocean, which yes does translate into ocean, but I don't know, it just sounds better to put ocean behind it. And that's it, all the places that I've covered so far. At the end, we get a map that looks like this. Oh yeah, I should also say I don't think I'm going to change the Atlantic either, because I don't think you could say it had inhabitants the same way the Pacific did, and the people who spent the most time here were definitely the Europeans, so I think it works to leave it. I hope you enjoyed this, and honestly, I'm curious if anyone would actually consider using any of these terms. Some sound and look better than others, so maybe you could suggest other names in the comments. I definitely missed a lot of different people groups and cultures, so I'd like to hear more. Of course, changing the name of a country, let alone a whole continent, would require a tremendous amount of work and collaboration between different groups. If you'd like to know why a country would go through this process, well, you're in luck, as I teamed up with WonderWhy on this, and he has a whole other video talking about just that over on his channel. He was actually one of the first YouTubers I ever watched, so it was incredibly exciting to get to work with him on this. So yeah, definitely check out his video next. Of course, thanks to my patrons over on Patreon for helping make this video and this whole channel possible. I'll be back next week with another one. Thanks.